So here's a little bit of mathematical magic. Let's just have a look at it. Now, five pieces. Move them around, recombine them, and we've turned one square into two squares. Ta-da! Not bad, huh? So one square into two squares, but of course there's one thing that actually doesn't change when you do this sort of thing. The area doesn't change. So if you calculate the area of the square that we started with and then the total area of the two squares that we end up with, it's going to be the same. And obviously you expect similar sort of things to happen whenever you cut something into pieces, recombine. The area shouldn't change, right? Right. Except there's this really, really famous theorem in mathematics, which is called the Banach-Tarski paradox. And Vsauce just did an amazing video on this just a couple of weeks ago. It says that you can take a solid ball. Well, it's got to be a mathematical ball. You can't actually do it with a real billiards ball or anything. So it's got to be a mathematical ball, solid. And you can split it up into a couple of different pieces. Okay. And then you can just kind of move around these pieces in space. You don't do anything with them. And recombine them like this. And you get two solid balls of exactly the same size as the one that you started with. So it's the same thing as before. You know, take one thing and turn it to two of the same shape. But the difference is that actually the volumes of both these resulting spheres are exactly the same as the one that you started with.
So you're doubling up.
Yeah, you're doubling up the volume. Wow. It's really crazy, you know. I mean, you really have to say this is only possible in the world of mathematics, right? Yeah. We're talking about dimensionless points and all kinds of other things. So this has got nothing to do with, you know, atoms or whatever. You know, it's in maths. In maths, you can do this sort of thing, right? It's a really, really good one. Now, when I first came across this one, this paradox, I actually wasn't that impressed. Why? Because I already knew quite a bit of mathematics and I played around with infinities and all this sort of stuff. So what I thought I'll do today is I'll do a prequel to the Vsauce video, okay? Which kind of puts you into the mind of
a young mathologer when he first encountered Banach-Tarski.
There's quite a few things that you won't find anywhere in textbooks here in this video, so it should be good. Okay, so when you think about this, what are we doing? We kind of take a shape and we kind of split it into bits. And then we move the bits around, and all of a sudden we've got something that's got double the area, volume, or whatever you want, okay? And actually, you can do this very, very easily, okay? Like this. So I just take this little segment there, and the bits I'm using are actually individual points that the segment is made up of, okay? And then I'm going to now teach every single point where to go. Okay, let's go. So I need some point up there, and some auxiliary line down there. And now I'm going to teach this point where to go, okay? So this point's going to go there, okay? Then this point's going to go there. Yeah? And every point goes the same way, right? So every point goes the same way. So now all the points know where to go. They all go to different places, right? And say, I'll just say, everybody now, all your points, you all go, right? So all go together and ta-da! Line segment of double the length that you had before, right? And really what you're doing here is kind of just stretching the whole thing, right? But when you think about it in terms of Banach-Tarski, you know, just think of the individual points. So the individual points, they all move and do anything else and then reassemble themselves into longer bits, right? And so if you do this one here or that one here or anything else, you can think of this as the same points rearranging themselves into these different shapes of different lengths, which is pretty amazing to start with, right?
So, but wouldn't there be empty spacing between those points?
Yeah, that's the thing. There is no empty space in between. Okay, and you can do the same sort of thing here with maybe, you know, squares. I kind of stretch it out. And you can think of, like, the individual points here kind of moving, rearranging themselves. And so it's always the same number of points. And actually, that's also why we say in mathematics that, like, this shape and all the ones we had before, they have the same infinite number of points, right? So, like all plane shapes with an area have the same infinite number of points. You can show on all linear shapes have the same number of points, right? So even that circle is the same number of points. So, but get yeah.
So quick question is then between a line segment and a line, an infinite line,
yeah,
then they have the same number of points.
They have the same number of points. Yeah, they have wow. The same number of points. They have the same infinite number of points. That's right. But it gets worse, right? It gets worse, right? So how can it get worse? Well, it actually turns out that this square and this segment here, have the same number of points.
Wow.
And actually, even the mathematicians who first found this, they couldn't believe their eyes. So I'll just quickly show you how this roughly goes. So basically, you have to teach the points in here where to go in there, okay? And it goes like this. So let's say this is like one. This is one unit, right? And so we take any point in the square, like that guy here. And that now has coordinates, okay? So it has coordinates like 0.2 something in the x direction and 0.6 in the y direction, okay? And now what we do is we kind of, do this. So we take the two numbers here and interleave them like this. And that gives you a new number down there, right? And that new number down there, well, is somewhere in this interval here. It's right there. So now we've taught this point where to go, okay? We've taught this point where to go. And every other point also knows where to go, right? Now we basically say go, right? And all the points from the square rearrange themselves into the interval. And, well, there's a little bit of a problem in here because some numbers have like two different decimal expansions, but can be fixed up nicely. That's the basic idea for rearranging all the points in the square into points of an interval. And you can do the same sort of things for cubes, right? For cubes, you've got like three coordinates, and you also zip them together like this. And so what all this means really is that blob infinity rules. So if you've got any blob of area or volume or length or whatever, right? It all consists of the same number of points. It's the same infinity that we're talking about. So I think that's pretty amazing, right? That's pretty amazing.
So virtually, any shape, any size, any object can be then compressed into a line.
Into a line.
With
the same number of points, you can make this thing as short as you want, as long as you want, infinitely long, doesn't matter. Right? So our whole space, like if you've got this little tiny line segment, contains exactly the same number of points as the infinite three-dimensional space that we live in, or the infinite four-dimensional space we live in, or whatever. Right? So, you know, pretty much anything which is somehow tangible in mathematics with a volume or an area or line, like this. But not all infinities are the same. You would think, well, after this, all infinities are the same. We've just been able to kind of collect everything together. But actually, there's infinitely many different infinities. So there's infinities that are a lot huger than what we've been talking about here. But you never see them you can make them up, but like, you know, in school or at uni, you really don't see them very often. But there's one below, at least one. And that's actually the one that people usually talk about. It's a counting infinity. Right? So whenever you've got an infinity where you can actually count the objects with like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then that's countable infinity. And that's actually really, really, really different from the blob infinity, okay? Well, we'll call it uncountable, right? Although uncountable also contains all those other infinities. But when we talk about, uncountable infinity, we just mean the blob infinity. Okay, so just in terms of points, well, we've got these points here on the number lines that correspond to 0, 1, 2, 3. So those points you cannot kind of reassemble into a line segment. Cannot be done. And actually, there's a really quick way of seeing this. And it's also, it's not a way that it's usually done, but it also shows you how much huger the blob infinity is than this infinity, okay? So here we go. So what we'll do is we'll just take a segment here which is 8 units long, okay? We take half of it and put the first point on it, call it the 0 point, right? We take half of the remaining bit and put point on and call it the 1 bit. And we just keep on going like this, like to infinity, right? To infinity. Get shorter and shorter line segments. Everyone in the middle has one of our points here, okay? And now what we'll do is we'll just take all these line segments, okay, and distribute them like on the infinitely long line, okay, the number line. We just put them on somewhere, okay? So anywhere you want. Even they can overlap. So maybe we want to avoid that the red points come together, okay? But apart from that, we can do anything you want, right? Anything whatsoever. Now, what's absolutely clear is that since these line segments start out adding up to, 8 units, no matter how you distribute them here, they're still going to add up to 8 units. And 8 units can't cover an infinite long line. So what it means is, no matter what you try here, you're always going to have a lot of empty space there where nothing is, right? Where you don't get anything, right? So with these segments, you can't cover the whole line. And what that also means is that with individual points, which are contained in the line segments, you can't, do the whole thing, right? You can't do the whole thing. And actually, when you think about it, you know, there's like heaps of space left over, right? There's infinity, and there's 8, right? And actually, that 8 you can make as small as you want, right?
Right.
So you could even ask, well, I mean, if I actually wanted to assemble these countably many points, like, you know, into something that can be measured in terms of length, you know, well, at the moment it would be less than 8, but since we could also have started out with an interval of length, you know, 1/Googleplex, or even smaller. So the logical conclusion is really, so if you actually wanted to measure this in terms of length, it would be 0. You know, so it's not much.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's huge, right? So there's a huge difference of when you talk about different infinities, it's really huge. Okay. So these are basically the two infinities that you get in maths, right? So these are all kinds of objects that you see, you know? And they fall into two different categories here in terms of infinities. So this is the countable infinity, and this is the uncountable infinity. So this is the blob infinity. Okay, so this is the blob infinity, and there's the other guys. Okay, and well, pretty neat, right? So I mean, I knew all this stuff before I started looking at Banach-Tarski. Now, Banach-Tarski. So what's the difference? So there was the Vsauce, the full thing, right? And then we had our version where we kind of, you know, so what's the difference? Well, there's a difference here in terms of, we just take the points here, right? Here they take big chunks, right? So there's, but we can actually do this in terms of big chunks too. So just imagine that we don't move the points, but we move these line segments that the square consists of, okay? So we can do this. Right? So the line segments kind of rearrange themselves, so it's big chunks. Or like in a three-dimensional way, you kind of slice this through this cube, right? You kind of do this and double the volume, right? Okay, so that's big chunks moving around in space, you know? So, yeah. Okay, that's very similar. There's still a difference, right? There's still a big difference here. So here, we have like uncountably many pieces that move, right? There, we've got finitely many. Right? That's a big difference. There's also something else which... it's quite important. When you look at the slices or the bits that are kind of moving around here, they are, well, they're very nicely well-defined, you know? So there's basically something that you think, well, it's very close to, you know, me cutting off a slice of cheese or something like this. If you look at these guys here, they're very fuzzy. They're very fuzzy, even mathematically. Even just to kind of make them up, you can't use scissors or anything. What comes out of here doesn't have any sort of properties like area or anything like this. And even to define them, you have to bring in like a really, really, really big gun in mathematics, which is actually a bit controversial, which is called the Axiom of Choice. So I'm not going to go into this, but there's something really weird here. Okay? And how can we see what's really amazing here? What really makes this thing amazing? Well, finitely many pieces. So just quickly, what does Vsauce do? Well, he cuts the ball up like this, okay? Then eventually, we kind of go like this. We just take one out. We rotate this piece by 90 degrees. And when we rotate it by 90 degrees, it turns into those four pieces together, which is really weird, right? And then we take, well, whatever's left over here, put that in, and that gives us the first ball with lots of stuff left over, okay? Then take that guy here, split it up into two pieces, rotate that one here by 90 degrees, and then all of those two together correspond to those three guys. Throw those two leftover ones back in. We just need this one and that one, which are actually small pieces, are countable pieces. We kind of, you can make them up from nothing, which is another trick. And we and we get these two solid balls, okay? Pretty amazing. You're ready now to watch this video. You should really watch this video. I haven't watched it yet. But now, what is amazing also is that actually this doesn't work for plane figures, for example. So if you tried the same thing for a circle, this is a solid circle, and you were to try and split this up into finitely many parts and recombine them in this way into two other circles, that actually doesn't work, right? So there's a lot more work there, and there's a lot more amazing stuff there, you know, when you really go all the way down to finite in this respect.
So it works. Primarily works because it's about infinites.
It's infinite, but this one here, you really need kind of this extra dimension to move around. And you actually see this when you watch the Vsauce video, that you need something extra. And yeah, that's basically it.
So